Judy Gay, Vice President for Academic Affairs at Community College of Philadelphia. Today I'm going to be interviewing Donald Scott. Donald is an assistant professor in the English department at the college. He has his bachelor's degree from Cheney University in English, and he has his master's degree in journalism from Columbia University. Welcome, Don.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for coming in. We're going to spend most of the time, I think, talking about Camp William Penn. You did extensive research on this facility, which started, I guess, around the time of the Civil War, 1863, at a time when they were recruiting black soldiers to participate in the Civil War.
Absolutely.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But before we do, I want to do a little side conversation, because in the acknowledgement of your book, you mentioned that your father-in-law was the first black graduate from the Naval Academy. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's very exciting, actually. He was the first black to graduate after 100 years. And before he attended the academy, beginning in 1945, there had been five other African Americans who tried to matriculate from the academy. They were hazed out. Occasionally, there was some sort of violence used against them. But historically, by 1949, he graduated and was the first African American to do so. So that's something we're very proud of as a family.
So that's a wonderful story in and of itself about that accomplishment. So maybe at some point in the future we can discuss that in more detail.
Oh, be more than happy to.
So Camp William Penn, how did you find out about this particular facility? It's very close to Philadelphia. And certainly plays a major role in the history of the Civil War. How did you get interested in this topic?
Actually, as a reporter for the Philadelphia Inquirer during the late 1980s, I wrote a number of stories regarding Cheltenham Township. Mm-hmm. One of the stories really hit a chord in me, which was about Camp William Penn. And I was just so fascinated that 11,000 black soldiers had trained there during the Civil War, that many of the major abolitionists of the period, including Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, and others, visited the camp and actually spoke there. And then I began to ponder, and I thought about the fact that information regarding the camp was not in local history books, statewide history books, and certainly not nationally. So I made it sort of a mission, or one of my missions, to expose and reveal the importance of Camp William Penn, and most importantly, the men who sacrificed and gave their lives for our country.
So that in 1863, if I understand correctly, Lucretia Mott lived in the area, and her son-in-law, I think, purchased the property that became Camp William Penn.
Yes, he actually owned the land.
He owned the land, okay.
And it was a number of acres, 13 acres exact, that Camp William Penn rose on. His name was Edward M. Davis. He was a well-known abolitionist who probably, from what we can tell, actually helped Frederick Douglass reach the North, the Philadelphia area, and beyond. And we know that he helped Frederick Douglass also move into England or speak in England in order to escape slave catchers.
Now, so a number of abolitionists, a number of people whose names we would recognize, have a connection to Camp William Penn. And Davis, apparently, not only did he own the land, but was also connected in a number of other ways. He was connected to the Union League, which was an organization that I guess developed somewhat differently than I always imagined. So it was a group of people that actually came together around the abolition movement. Is that true?
Yes, that is. Okay. And he was a prominent member of the Union League. The Union League actually raised funds to establish Camp William Penn. And there are various figures, but up to $100,000 to establish Camp William Penn and to also help with other causes related to the abolitionist movement. So he was very important with respect to raising those funds, organizing, and the fact that he was the son-in-law of Lucretia Mott really helped the situation. Mm-hmm. From what we can tell through research, it was a very close knit community in terms of the powerful abolitionists. So we know that Mary Brown, the wife of John Brown, actually stayed at Lucretia Mott's nearby house when John Brown was being executed. Mm.
So that, again, a lot of figures that we are pretty familiar to us in terms mm-hmm. of the history of the period were have an association to that particular camp. Now, in 1863, this was a radical shift, it sounds like, where there was a decision that African Americans could actually be recruited to serve as soldiers, to participate in the war in that way, so that both free blacks, runaway slaves, and I guess the officers were white at the camp, that this was the first facility in the North, I think, and the largest facility in the North for training black recruits.
Right, and the key is federal.
Oh, federal,
so,
okay.
Right, so federal. And then you get the term the United States Colored Troops. Mm-hmm. So that was a bureau established under Abraham Lincoln. It's important to note, though, that at first Abraham Lincoln was reluctant to bring in black troops. Mm-hmm. With pressure from people like Frederick Douglass, William Lloyd Garrison, probably Lucretia Mott to a degree, he realized, especially as the Battle of Gettysburg
was waging,
That the Union was actually very much in danger. Mm-hmm. So with that combination of issues, he knew that black troops had to be recruited.
Mm-hmm. His reluctance initially, if I remember correctly, had to do with the border states and a concern about whether they would continue to support the Union if, in fact, African Americans were allowed to become soldiers.
Yes, that was one primary factor. The other issue is that Abraham Lincoln was a product of his times. Right. So we know that initially in Abraham Lincoln's career, he did maintain views, biased views against blacks. Mm-hmm. It's known that he gave speeches using the N-word mm-hmm. early in his career. And there's other evidence that indicates. But I think the beauty of Abraham Lincoln is that he rose from being someone who may have had racist views to someone who realized that as he saw the country going through this transformation, that his views had to also change in order to save the Union. Mm-hmm. So that is very important with respect to Abraham Lincoln. And I think that's what makes him great, his growth and his maturity during that period.
Right, that changes over time. That shows how his thinking, his ability to listen to other people's points of view
exactly.
and to make decisions moving forward that were in the best interest of the country, but also
exactly.
kind of reflected a certain moral and philosophical stance.
Mm-hmm.
So what was the attraction to becoming a soldier for the African-American, and I guess it was all men, African-American men, what was in it for them to actually commit to this battle and to say, yes, I want to participate? Was the thinking that this will change the point of view in terms of African Americans in communities, that people would think differently about African Americans because we were participating in the Civil War?
Yes, that's exactly it. We know that many of the men who did enter through the gates of Camp William Penn were actually runaway slaves. So they wanted their freedom. They needed their freedom. We know that when Frederick Douglass spoke there, most likely in late July 1863, more precisely probably July 24th, 1863, we know that he addressed the men, and that was one of his primary topics. He wanted them to realize that in order to get recognition and equal rights in America as black people, that they should realize performing in the Civil War, being victorious, brave, courageous, would lead to what he believes freedom.
And initially, in terms of the surrounding community, I know that in your book you mentioned that the soldiers, when they were being transported to locations where they would go into battle, you know, went into Philadelphia, and they were, I guess, using the Pennsylvania Railroad system for transport. But that there were some initially, when the camp opened, Philadelphia did not want the troops parading through town. They were afraid that there might be riots. And so initially it was pretty, I can't say secretive, but it seemed as though there was a lot of concern about not having a lot of fanfare around the soldiers from Camp William Penn. But over time, it sounds like when nothing happened, when the troops were transported, that this became an occasion for a lot of fanfare. There were parades, relatives, people were coming to cheer and to look at the troops. So over time, it sounds as though people kind of liked the idea of Camp William Penn and the fact that these soldiers were preparing for battle in that location.
That's true. In fact, on weekends, it was a spectacle.
Oh, really?
So many people from the Philadelphia area, and from what I understand, beyond, they would even come from Maryland, because it was the first federal and largest federal camp to train black soldiers. So you have these people coming in on weekends just to see the men parade. So it was really quite an event. And when you think about that and the importance of Camp William Penn then, and then the absence of it in the history books today, I think it makes it even more relevant that we examine and the phenomenon of Camp William Penn.
And I guess they did a lot of marketing to get people to know about the camp, because in your book you also show posters of kind of the call to arms and letting people know that the camp existed. And that may be one of the ways that they were able to get so many men, I guess, to say that they wanted to be involved in the war.
Exactly. And at the bottom of those broadsides, you would have the names of people like Frederick Douglass, Octavius Cato, and others. So the local black men, and sometimes, well, often, when with names like Frederick Douglass, even beyond Philadelphia, men would be identify with those names.
So it really did have quite a major place in history at that time. People knew, if you said Camp William Penn, people knew what you were talking about.
Absolutely, right, especially in this region.
Now, there's one event that you recount in the book that, you know, a very unfortunate event. It sounds like that there was a private who was supposed to guard the facility, one of the men that was guarding the facility, and a member of the community attempted to get into the facility, and the member of the community, who was white, was shot and killed by the private.
Yes, right, right.
So could you tell me a little bit more about that story?
Yeah, and in fact, that did create an uproar because there was a lot of publicity regarding that particular incident. But I think the most remarkable thing regarding that incident is that the camp commander actually defended the black recruit. And so that I believe that's very important and representative of Louis Wagner, who was the commander. The recruit did eventually serve time in jail. Mm-hmm. I believe it was in Norristown. But again, most important to me is that, and it was indicated a number of times with the black recruits, that Colonel Wagner, eventually General Wagner, would come to the defense of those black recruits. Even there was one instance of a slave catcher actually trying to enter the grounds of Camp William Penn. The black recruits, let's say, forced or repelled the slave catcher. And it's our understanding that the commander did not chastise or punish the black recruits for repelling. So there are several instances where Wagner actually defends blacks with respect to segregation issues. So when his men are attacked, even physically in the city, he fights for their rights and defends them. So there are many interesting and great things about Colonel Wagner, or General Wagner.
Was he recruited to, or asked to take the, to be the commander of the post because he had abolitionist views? Do you think, was he, or is there any evidence that he was selected because he already had those views coming into that position? And was he selected because he had views that would be kind of favorable to African Americans?
I wouldn't be surprised if his views were noted with respect to the assignment at Camp William Penn. Historically, Germans were known to be abolitionists in the Philadelphia area, and that went existed well before Colonel Wagner. So there were Germans in the community who signed on to the original petition, I believe in 1681, to protest slavery in Germantown. And so the tradition of people of German heritage, Germantown, and so on, has a lot to do with probably his heritage, and then recognition that for his abolitionist points of view.
Now he was injured in battle before he got this position. Apparently his leg had been shattered or...
The second battle of Bull Run.
Oh, really?
Right.
Okay. Yeah. I didn't notice that. So he had... a great reputation as a warrior. You use the term warriors when you talk about the soldiers
yes,
in the book
yes,
a lot.
Right.
So he had a great reputation as a warrior himself, and he was relatively young when he took over command of the post.
Right, he must have been his
20s.
Late 20s, yeah. 26, 27.
Okay. Yeah. Right. So a significant responsibility
yeah, absolutely.
For a person so young. But again, I imagine that as a model for the men at the camp, having someone who had that great kind of history around the military was also inspirational. Not only was he fair to them and treated them presumably pretty well, but also that he was a model for, I guess, the soldier's life and what you could do and the importance of serving the country in that way.
Absolutely. Yep. He was. He was exemplary, and I think another thing that we should note is that he had close ties with people like Lucretia Mott. So he wasn't in a vacuum. He would conference with Lucretia Mott, and I'm sure strategize. They had many of the same goals. So that Quaker and German history of helping African Americans early on is very important. Mm-hmm. That's not to say that early Quakers did not own slaves.
And Lucretia Mott was a Quaker.
Right? Yes, so, okay. Right. Lucretia Mott was a prominent Quaker and actually a very well-known Quaker preacher or minister. So she was very eloquent, not only in defending black rights, but also women's rights.
Right. I think of her actually more in the context, usually when I think about Lucretia Mott, I think of her more in the context of women's rights than I think of her as an abolitionist.
Yes.
That was a nice,
right.
Your book was right. A nice reminder mm-hmm. that she actually had those views across a variety of topics.
So. Right. At one point, she was known basically as the most well-known woman in America. Mm. So that had a lot to do with her women's rights initiatives.
Now, what can you tell me about how the troops did? So 11,000 men come to Camp William Penn at different times, so maybe 1,000 at a time to train, and then they are sent off to war. Do you have any stories about what happened to some of the regiments?
Yeah. The most recognized regiment from Camp William Penn was the 6th USCT, and that was the second regiment to leave Camp William Penn. They actually fought in a battle, the Battle of Chaffin's Farm in Virginia, or New Market Heights. That was September, I believe, of 1864. Several of them actually won the Medal of Honor for saving the flag during battle, even though they were injured, faced tremendous fire by the Confederate troops. They performed extremely well and did receive that recognition for that. There was another regiment called the 8th USCT out of Camp William Penn. I believe they followed the 6th. There are issues regarding whether they were adequately trained or whether they had enough time to train. But anyway, they ended up in a place called Alusti, Florida. They were pitted against a very hardened group of Confederate soldiers, and many of them were actually slaughtered. But one thing was noted, that they generally performed well under fire, that they faced death, imminent death, and many of them were taken prison as prisoners and ended up in Andersonville and a couple of other notorious prisons and died as a result. So the other regiments did such things as actually track President Abraham Lincoln's assassins.
Oh.
They were the first to enter Richmond, Virginia, or among the first troops to enter Richmond, Virginia. They led the parade of Abraham Lincoln's funeral. So there are many things that they did during the Civil War, fighting in just about every major battle from 1863 forward. By the end of the war, some of them actually end up serving in the Buffalo Soldiers in Texas. So that's something that we're investigating now to get more information about, but we do know that some of them ended up in those units.
And generally speaking, because a number of people presumably enlisted with a hope that people would see African Americans differently and that our lives might be different during that period of time. What happened after the war was over and people kind of went back to their lives? Did they have experiences that they would, did they expect that they would be treated like heroes and that you would have recognition as a, I guess as a veteran, did they get the kinds of treatment that white veterans got from the Civil War in terms of any compensation for widows or compensation for themselves? How were they treated after the war was over?
They did get compensation, often gradually though, and sometimes not at all. We know that a great example is Harriet Tubman. Although she eventually did receive a pension, she had a difficult time getting it. And therefore, if I backtrack just a little, Harriet Tubman actually led Union troops into battle during the Civil War. She actually scouted. She treated them as a nurse. So there are many things that she did that endangered her and her life. If you compare her with the only woman to ever earn the Medal of Honor, Mary Walker, their track records are pretty much the same. Mm-hmm. However, Harriet Tubman's track record during the Civil War was a bit more notable. Mm-hmm. So there were soldiers locally in the Cheltenham area, Norristown, and New Jersey, black soldiers. There are accounts at the National Archives indicating that they had a tremendous time getting their pensions, even their widows. Now, there's an upside and a downside to that. The upside is that we're able to examine their documents, and they are actually writing letters expressing their ingratitude, but also they are giving us records of where they were, giving us details of battles, telling us who their friends were, and that sort of thing. So we're able to get a clearer picture of what happened to them during the Civil War and what happened to them after the Civil War.
Since the story wasn't in the history books when you first became interested in the topic and started looking into it, how hard was it to find so much information? Because one of the things that's wonderful about your book is so many pictures, so much information, but it must have been quite an effort to find everything and to put it together, to put the story together.
Yes, it was, but the information, although hard to get sometimes, is and was available. And I think that's very important. And at the National Archives, you can get information on many of the soldiers from General Wagner through to the lowest private. At the Army Institute of History in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, U.S. Army Army History Institute in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, there's plenty of information regarding the white officers at Camp William Penn. That, to me, makes it more of a violation in a way that the story concerning Camp William Penn is just really coming to light. Mm-hmm. Other information's harder to come by. To get some details regarding black recruits, I actually had to resort to the internet and the web, and I contacted descendants of those soldiers. Mm-hmm. I was able to gather great information from those sources. A woman, Carol Cook from Washington, D.C., an administrator at one of the local universities, actually sent me an album of images over the internet that involved several of her Civil War ancestors. So overall, I would say that getting the information was moderately hard, but it was accessible, and there is just so much information that I am getting as the weeks go by. Last week, I received an email from my publisher who said that a company in Canada, in conjunction with PBS, is doing a documentary on William Steele, and that they would like to talk with me regarding aspects of my book and Camp William Penn. William Steele was the father of the Underground Railroad. And he actually operated a dispensary at Camp William Penn.
Okay.
So we know from that that there are many connections between with the Underground Railroad and Camp William Penn.
So it's really an exciting story.
Yeah, it is incredible, isn't it?
And I think with your determination and once you got it started, then the information did start to become more available. I guess once you find a few pieces of information, you can start to fan out and get other sources.
Yes, and one thing leads to the other.
Right. Now, your background is in journalism, and when I think of journalists, I think of reporting on what's happening now, mm-hmm. as opposed to what happened in the past. So how does a journalist get involved in a historical topic, and what kinds of skills do you bring as a journalist to the search for information that's different from what a historian might bring to the situation?
Well, I think the important thing is to look for news angles. And I think in virtually anything, even when it comes to things that happened in the past, there's a news angle. Mm-hmm. And what I've done with respect to my history column for a group of local newspapers in Montgomery County, mm-hmm. is to evaluate a story not only from the historic point of view, but also if it's something that will make people raise their eyebrows, but then also related to what's happening today. Mm-hmm. So those are important elements to me. With my interest in history over the years, and then the interest in news, I've been able to, I think, delve into some pretty important areas.
You know, there's a lot of conversation these days about whether or not students should go into journalism, that is there going to be a job for you, mm-hmm. if you have a career in journalism. But it looks like you have expanded in terms of what you do. It's not just looking at a current situations, but also looking into the past from a news person's perspective and looking for the story and telling it a little bit differently. So what would you say to students who might be interested in going into journalism at this point? Is there a career? Can you make a career for yourself based on your interests and you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the focus for students today should be on new technology, the internet, the web, cable, television. So new technology would be the focus. I think there's still room for print vehicles such as newspapers and magazines. Mm-hmm. A student starting off should try to get an internship, perhaps with a newspaper or magazine, because often the web companies have smaller staffs. Okay. Getting in on the ground level with respect to internships and smaller newspapers, possibly getting a position in a larger newspaper, which would be more difficult given these times, mm-hmm. And then focusing also on the web. I think there is definitely a future for mm-hmm. Students in the news business.
And I guess if you love it, you'll make a way.
Oh,
for
yes, absolutely.
In terms of doing that.
Absolutely.
So, what's your next project? What are you working on now? And what do you have your sights on for the future?
Actually, I'm looking at a couple of the soldiers from Camp William Penn.
Okay. So, going into more detail about individuals.
Yes,
okay.
Right. One very interesting guy is Josiah Walls. Josiah Walls was a private in the 3rd Regiment. He was actually, before joining the 3rd Regiment, he was a slave. He was captured or recruited, let's say, by the Confederate Army. So he served the Confederacy,
wow.
But...
Reluctantly, I guess.
Yes, exactly, okay. Right. But was picked up by Union forces. Mm-hmm. Eventually, he ends up in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. He has no education. There are reports that he had probably the equivalent of 1 year education in Harrisburg. Mm-hmm. He eventually ends up at Camp William Penn, joining the 3rd USCT, probably during the summer of 1863. He serves that unit. He moves up in rank a little bit. But following the war, which is very remarkable, he moves back to Florida and he becomes a politician, a congressman. He actually also buys himself a farm and ends up owning the largest farm in the state. He actually purchases a farm of a Confederate soldier who owned a plantation.
Well, that is a pretty remarkable story.
Yeah, that is. So that's incredible. He hires, he eventually buys a newspaper, mm-hmm. and he hires some of the officers who trained him at Camp William Penn as editors. Right. So he becomes somewhat prominent in Florida politics. He is recognized for introducing a couple of landmark bills having to do with public education, tourism, agriculture, and a number of other bills that in areas that we still talk about today.
So is this somebody that you got the information from both? I mean, because he was a politician, there probably are actual mm-hmm. records, but did you get this from family and from public records, the information about?
Most of the information, believe it or not, that I received about Josiah Walls was by cross-checking various facts and getting a hit on the internet.
Oh, really? Right? Again,
getting a hit on the internet. So that was very important. And then from there, I began to go to various repositories. I found a very brief book about him. I think it's about 100 pages of an author who wrote it in Florida. Mm-hmm. And I found other information that told of his story. By the end of his life, he, and this is one of the really sad parts about his life, his wife dies. I think he's probably about age 55, 56 years old. He loses his farm due to a freeze. So he grew oranges.
An environmental freeze? Oh,
yes,
okay.
Right, an environmental freeze. Mm-hmm. So there was actually a weather freeze. Mm-hmm. Froze a lot of his crops, including many oranges. And he ends up just living with his daughter. Mm-hmm. His daughter develops mental problems, and she is accused of actually a murder. She ends up in an institute and she dies. Throughout the years, he's aggravated by some of his war injuries. Mm-hmm. So there's an indication that he was really in great pain during the last years of his life. He moves on to another property, however, and begins to grow crops and students. There's a school started on the property, and that school eventually becomes Florida A&M University.
Oh, really?
Right.
This is a remarkable story.
Mm-hmm. He died really unrecognized. Hmm. So he dies unrecognized. And there's a question about even today where he's buried.
And how did you, so by researching Camp William Penn, mm-hmm. you run across him and then start to follow the trail of his life from
yes,
this work
exactly.
that he's done.
So. Right. And there are many other instances of people or soldiers from Camp William Penn who basically started off as slaves and rose to tremendous levels. There's a gentleman I mentioned in the book named Richardson who has somewhat of a similar background. It doesn't rise to the heights of Josiah Walls, but still in the end, his rise is quite remarkable. And even some of the white officers end up doing great things. There's one white officer named Horace Bumstead. He eventually ends up in Georgia as a university official. He rises to the rank of president of the university.
Wow. He becomes the president of Atlanta University.
Right. So he's an officer from one of the units at Camp William Penn. I believe it's the third USCT. He eventually ends up with a job at Atlanta University, rises to become president of the university. Along the way, and as the years progress, he brings in a young black professor who has a lot of potential and aptitude. He's just completed a study at the University of Pennsylvania and progressed on his book entitled The Philadelphia Negro. And that is W.E.B.
Du Bois. Right.
So he had a lot to do with helping Du Bois finish and help to fund some of the great research of Du Bois. He's also indicated in helping to set up the apparatus for the NAACP. As we know, Du Bois was a co-founder of that great organization.
So are you envisioning another book with several of these stories?
Absolutely,
specifically?
Right. So I would like to focus on approximately five of them.
Okay, what happened to them after they were at Camp William Penn? So all of these will be individuals who have a connection to Camp William Penn.
Right.
But what happened to
them
afterwards?
Right, and I will focus some on their war experience also. And even before with those who started out as slaves.
Mm-hmm. Well, it absolutely is a remarkable story. I so much appreciate having a chance to read the book.
Oh, thanks.
To look at the wonderful pictures and to learn something new about that time period. So thank you, Don. It's wonderfully done, and I would encourage anybody to look at your book and to learn a little bit more about that particular period of time. And I certainly look forward to the next book to hear about those individuals who went on to do some remarkable things.
Oh, thanks for having me. It's been my pleasure.
Thank you for joining us. This was a wonderful interview. We hope to see you at the next one.